God bless you. Thank you for being with us today. We are Abundant Grace Church. I'm Bishop Ramon DeMaria. I'm the pastor of Abundant Grace Church. And truly, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall all rejoice and be glad in it. We just praise God today because He has given us another day. Amen. You know, God is in control of everything. And some this morning He called home to be with Him. Others He allowed us to stay here for another day. So we thank God for the opportunity to be here. And as Paul the Apostle says, I'd rather be with the Lord. But it is more pertinent that I be here with you today. So I just pray that through this message today that God touches somebody's heart and that they give their life to Jesus Christ, that they may have eternal life as we do. Amen? So our message title is Quiet Time with God. And so far we did parts 1, 2, and 3. And today we're going to close out with part 4. Amen? So today we will open up with Psalm 46 and verse 8, which reads firstly from the King James Version. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations He has made in the earth. And the Bible in Basic English renders it, come see the works of the Lord, the destruction which He has made in the earth. My beloved, let's go back to the flood. This is what we're talking about. Look at the devastation and the desolation that was left after the flood. There was nothing there after the flood. Not one human being was living after the flood except Noah and his family. And of course, the animals that he had with him. But you know, God promised by the sign of the rainbow that He would not destroy the earth by water again. And Peter reminds us that He will destroy the world by fire. There will be a cleansing and a purging. And there will be a new heaven and a new earth. Okay? So, there won't be any more floods. Now, we've had floods, understand. But not a worldwide flood. We've had floods in Texas. When it rains hard, we have floods. People perish. Things like that happen. But it's not a destructive thing where all mankind is wiped out from the face of the earth. Okay? Now, actually speaking, when you look at it from this certain perspective, that everything on the earth perished. But think about this, that Noah and his family weren't part of the earth, because when the waters came, when the grounds broke and the springs came up and the clouds opened up, burst open, let's say, and the waters came, the ark was lifted up. So they were no longer part of this earthly society of people. They became separated. They were like in a vacuum. They were separated from all the evil of the world at that time. So they were kept in solitude for 40 days and 40 nights. They were kept safe by God. And that's the way we are, being in Christ. We are kept in Christ. We are sealed with the Spirit of promise until the day of redemption. So, what the verse is saying here is, come behold the works of the Lord, of His nature and His grace, especially those of providence, both in a way of judgment and His mercy. God judged the world at the time of the flood, and he showed mercy to Noah and his family. Okay? So what desolations he has made in the earth, he got rid of every living thing, every person, every animal, everything. He got rid of. They drowned in a flood. Now you can only go so high on the mountain, there's no more mountain, then water arose, okay? So that's verse 8. Now verse 9, well, let me, just let me go to verse 9. It says, he maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear asunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. That's the King James. And the God's Word version renders it. He puts an end to wars all over the earth. He breaks an archer's bow. He cuts spears in two. He burns chariots. Each great deliverance can only be advanced by God. Look at how many wars there have been since the beginning of time. And every war has come to an end. And because of man and his ego and his wanting to be all powerful and to have everything, wars start. Simple reasons wars start. Finances, territory, people, loves, everything else. These are all the things that start wars. All these things. Everything to do with the flesh. These wars start. But they do end. But then another one will pick up. When the greatest empire, the Roman Empire, was dissolved. Babylonian Empire, the Grecian Empire, was dissolved. Look at all the wars. Right now we have small wars going all over the world. They too will end. But there will never be peace on the earth until Jesus Christ returns. I just want to make that fact plain, that there will never be peace until the return of the Prince of Peace, who is Jesus Christ. Amen? Mm-hmm. So now I'm going to go into our main verse today, which is Psalm 46 and verse 10, which reads as follows, firstly from the King James Version, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth." That's pretty strong words. I. The great I am is speaking here. The eternal God and Savior is speaking here. Now, the Bible in basic English renders it, "Be at peace in the knowledge that I am God. I will be lifted up among the nations. I will be honored through all the earth." A nation that doesn't honor God will never be successful. Never. Nations have tried it. Pagans, anti-God, ungodly nations. They did not succeed. You know why the United States has been so powerful? Because they always put God first. Now, we're seeing a change in the tide. But you know, God is still a God that answers prayer. And that's why we need to pray. We need to pray for God to have mercy on us, to restore us back to Him. We need to pray for a revival, a renewing, a great outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We need to recognize that we can do nothing without God in our lives. Without God as the head of our nation, we can do nothing. Look at the decline of our nation when they took prayer out of school. When they started removing God. The nation changed, so we need to get back to the basics, to biblical teaching. That God is the source of our strength. God is what's going to keep our nation afloat. God is the one that is going to defeat our enemies.
Amen.
God is our only hope through His Son, Jesus Christ, to be victorious. And we need to continue to move on, to go on, and to take the gospel to every creature, to compel them to come into the house of the Lord. We should have to have a catastrophic event take place for people to return to God. They should do it willingly, even without thought. Do it automatically. Return to God. One of our praises this morning. Return to God. He's our only hope. Lord, give me one more chance. Let me love you. Let me prove myself to you. Return to God. God will meet you anywhere, at any time, as you seek Him. Seek God for all that you need. So, one more verse. One more translation I'm going to read in Psalm 46, verse 10. And that comes from the God's Word version. And I put it here because it adds a little more light to what I'm trying to say. It says, let go of your concerns. Then you will know that I am God. I rule the nations. I rule the earth. See, when you are so engulfed, let me say that again. When you are so engulfed in the problems of this world, you won't have time to concentrate on the things of God. Because you're going to be thinking about everything else instead of God, who is able to deliver you from any situation, from your present situation. Don't be wrapped up. Don't be engulfed in all these other things. Don't let what's happening in the world overtake you in fear and have you live a life of fear where you don't want to make a decision. You don't want to do it. You don't want to go out. There's some people, they fear going out because they read the news and something's going to happen. Just watch news all day, all day, all day. They're afraid to get on a bus, get on an airplane, get on a train, go to the store. They're afraid to do anything because they read everything that is happening in the newspaper. They watch TV and you're not going to get any good news. It's sensationalism. You're going to get all the bad news. What's happening? Who was shot? Who was raped here? Who was held up here? What is happening here? What is happening there? Look up, a missile's going to come from North Korea. Missile's going to come from here. You can't live in fear. Paul traveled the Aegean way, walked miles and miles. He said, I was amongst robbers and thieves, fear for my life. But guess what? I still went on to preach the gospel. We went into foreign nations to preach the gospel. Because we knew that God would protect us. And we would return back. Because God had a plan and a purpose for us. He wanted someone in another nation to get saved. Where they wouldn't perish. They wouldn't go to hell. And we went and we came back. God opened doors and God closes doors. He takes you and He brings you back. He has a plan for each and every one of us. But we must seek God for our plan. So let go of all your concerns. And know that God is God. He is in control. If He's not in control, you have no hope anyway. So invest in the truth of the Word of God. Invest in the all-powerful God, the all-powerful Creator. Invest in Him. Because He is the one that rules every situation. He has the last word. Matter of fact, He has the first word and the last word. If you allow something to happen, He has a reason for it. God is in total control. So it says, be still and know that I am God. God requires man to cooperate with Him. Let me say that again. God requires man to cooperate with Him, to follow His rules, His commands, His regulations. God isn't subject to us and what we feel is right to do. God is in control. We are to obey Him in every situation. He doesn't have to obey us. Some people teach that, hey, just demand God do this. Tell Him, do this, do this. That's crazy. You petition God. You beg God to do something. You ask God to do something. You don't demand Him. Now, you can go to His Word and say, Lord, Your Word says this, and I'm depending on Your Word as being true, that You will move on my behalf. But even so, let Your will be done. When Jesus was in the garden, laboring, He says, Lord, if it is possible, He says, Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass, but yet not Your will be done. That's what we need to pray that way. Lord, Your will be done. I'm asking You, but Your will be done. I am willing to accept Your answer. I need healing, or I need deliverance, or my mother and father need healing, or my children need this. But Lord, Your will be done, because I know You have a plan and a purpose for what You allow to happen. See, my beloved, God says, I will be exalted among the heathen. God is going to cause the heathen to exalt God. You can look all through the Old Testament and see what God had the heathen cater to Him. Even Pharaoh did, momentarily. But then he changed his mind. He saw the power of God move. Do you think for 1 minute that the Egyptians wanted to go into the Red Sea when it was parted? Do you think they weren't scared? They were, but they had to obey. I mean, the Egyptians had to obey Pharaoh, but God allowed them to go there and destroy Pharaoh's army. And after that, Egypt was never a power again. Isn't it amazing how these things happen? God brings people to their knees where they have to admit that God is all powerful. You even see atheists turn into God because they see the truth that God is in control. A lot of strong Christians now were atheists at one time, or pacifists. And they didn't believe in the God, they didn't believe anything until God allowed some catastrophic thing to happen in their life. And it turned to God. So how stupid could I be? I was wrong. Matter of fact, when God calls us and we say no, we're the same thing. We're in the same boat. We're pagans, we're unbelievers. Everyone's a pagan until they come to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord. People believe in a God, oh, a big God, this big thing in the sky. They don't know the true God, okay? They don't know who He is. But once you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you know what the truth is. So God will cause the heathen, nations, to accept Him. One proof of that, let me just offer one proof of that before we move on. Rome. They were pagans. The Christians went and preached, even to Caesar's household. Rome, from the Roman Empire, turned into the Holy Roman Empire. And then from there, They went into different countries, Spain, England, all over, and eventually to the New World, to North America, Central and South America. They went to the Middle East, they went to the East, they went to the Orient to spread the word of God. That's why we are, we have this world we have today. But yet, even in the Christian world, there were unbelievers, there were pagans, there were atheists. There are antichrists. But one day, they were all believing. But it'll be a shame because they'll know the truth when they get to hell. Then it'll be too late. That's why we have a responsibility as Christians to take the gospel, that they may have the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ. That's why we do what we do. He says, I will be exalted in the earth. I mean, exaltation among the neighboring heathen. You know, your next door neighbor could be unsaved. The person you work with on the assembly line could be unsaved. The person at the cash register in the store could be unsaved. That's why wherever I go, there are things I wear a shirt, Abundant Grace Church, talk about God, Christ, you know, so they can see. My hat, too. Jesus is every part of me. And sometimes, well, most of the time, I don't have to say anything. I let my vestments speak for me. Of course, my attitude has to be right. And my posture has to be right. Because what they see, no matter what you say, what they see tells it all. You have to let your walk match your talk. So we have to exalt God by our lifestyle. Exalt God by letting people see the one that lives in us. And that is Jesus Christ. So he says, be still, okay? Don't worry about anything. Don't let the concerns of this world bother you. And how do you get this peace? First of all, you have to spend quiet time with God. You have to be in prayer and the study of the Word of God so you know what is in the mind of God. How could you know me unless you spend time with me, right? You know, when people get married, it is customary for to get married to be engaged for a year. And then they get to know each other, but then they still don't know each other until so many years into their marriage. Because they get to know one another. And they usually put a rule there. If you make it after 7 years, make it past 7 years, you got it made. But marriage is a lifetime commitment. And that's the same as our relationship with Jesus Christ. I said all that to say this, is a lifetime commitment. We grow up in a Christian home or whatever, we hear about Christ, we go to church, that doesn't mean we're saved. Then it comes a time when God says, okay, now, is the time to come to me. And he keeps you through fires, through floods, through everything else, until he brings you to that 1 second, that one moment, to where that conviction is so strong that you can't reject it. And you say, yes, Lord, to your will. Not my will, but your will. But beloved, to know God, you must spend time with them. It's like to know your spouse, you must spend time with them. Jesus is the groom, and he is calling people to be his bride. That you may get to know him, have intimacy with him, have fellowship with him. And you can only get to know him by prayer, reading of the word, supplication, fasting. You can only get to know him by having that intimate relationship with him. So all the four parts, including today, which is four, three other parts of four, has all led up to this, having quiet time with God. And you may get to know him in a mighty way. Paul says that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. Know what you have through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because he has risen from the dead. We just celebrated Easter a couple weeks back. We have eternal life. Eternal life is there for anyone that chooses to accept it. That's why today, at the close of this message, I want to offer to you that are watching this video, or those that are listening to the audio portion of it, that God loves you and he sent Jesus to die for you. He wants to have an intimate relationship with you. He is there waiting for you, calling you through this message. I want quiet time with you. I want a relationship with you. Please come to me. That's what he's saying. And if you would love to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, I want to lead you in a prayer. You pray this prayer and mean it from your heart. You must believe that God sent Jesus Christ, that God sent his word. He took the form of man. His name is Jesus of Nazareth. He walked this earth 3.5 years preaching the gospel. He was crucified, died, buried in a borrowed tomb, rose from the dead on the third day, ascended into heaven, is now sitting at the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for all the saints. If you believe that today, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, I heard the message today, Quiet Time with God, Part 4. I believe the message today. I believe the gospel. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior of all mankind. I believe everything about him by faith. I want to repent of my sins and accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. I am sorry for my sins. I ask you to forgive me my sins and wash me and cleanse me of all unrighteousness, to lead me and guide me in a path that you want me to travel down. I am giving you my life. I'm giving you my all in all, my everything. I want to serve you. I want to go to heaven when I leave this life and not to hell. And the only way for that to happen is for me to accept your plan of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. And I do that today. And I believe that through my repentance, I have received eternal life through your Son, Jesus Christ. And I thank you today. In Jesus' name I pray. We'd love if you said that prayer today and you meant that prayer from your heart. Let me be the first to welcome you into the kingdom of God. And what I want you to do is go to a Bible preaching, teaching church, speak to the pastor, tell him what happened, ask him to anoint you with oil, to pray for you, to pray with you, to help you with any problems that you have in your life, to lead you down the right path. Ask him for a Bible if you haven't one. Ask him to mentor you. Ask him to help you in any way that is needed for you to become a strong Christian. And ask him also to baptize you by full immersion in water in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And what else I want you to do is please contact me at abundant.grace@att.net. That's abundant.grace@att.net. You can also contact us through our website at www.abundantgracechurch.net. You can also contact us through our other website at www.abundantgraceofmidlothian.com. Midlothian spelled M-I-D-L-O-T-H-I-A-N. Now you can also just Google us, Abundant Grace Church of Midlothian, my name Bishop Ramon D. Maria, and you will see our outreach ministries there on YouTube, Ustream, Facebook, Twitter. Please contact us. Remember, our email address is abundant.grace@att.net, and just earmark it, Pastor, and I will get it. Thank you for being with us today. Once again, our message has been Quiet Time with God, Part 4. You can watch all of the parts 1, 2, 3, and of course Part 4 on YouTube. You can also listen to the edited audio portion on Spreaker.com under my name, Bishop Ramon D. Maria, or Bishop Full Gospel New Life. Thank you, my beloved, for being with us today. We pray that God continue to bless you and reward you with his many blessings, and that you walk down that straight and narrow path, and that you walk in victory, which can only come through our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you, my beloved, and go with God.